You're listening to international investment advisor Doug Goldstein on the Goldstein on Gelt show, the financial show where we'll talk about how you can make the most of your money. With all the confusing financial chatter bombarding you each and every day, Goldstein on Gelt will give you the practical information you want and need about living a financially stable life. Here's your host, money maven Doug Goldstein.
Okay, we are back. We are talking to Bernard Goetz from New York. In fact, I knew him when I was young in New York in 1984. He was involved in changing the way New Yorkers see crime. He defended himself against a few teenagers who tried to mug him. In fact, his bravery is probably what woke New York City residents up to realize that they no longer had to live in fear. And 20 years later, New York, instead of being one of the most dangerous cities in the world, became one of the safest cities in the world. Bernard Goetz, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Listen, I'd like to talk to you about what you're involved in now. I understand that recently you've run for mayor and for public advocate in New York City, and very much based on a lot of what's going on with the World Trade Center. What is going on there now?
Well, right now, what's going on is they finished the memorial section, and so people can visit that. And they're in a financial bind because the plans are so impractical and bizarre that they ran out of money despite massive federal initial federal funding, and they just had a huge toll increase for all the Port Authority bridges and tunnels, a 50% increase, and what they're in effect doing is they're making New Jersey commuters and people who live on Staten Island pay for the World Trade Center site. And it's just the project I consider a fiasco. It was a fiasco when they chose the initial site plans. And in general, there's been, for the past 8 years, the New York government here has been misleading the public on it. Larry Silverstein basically isn't paying anything for the project. About a year and a half ago, they announced with great fanfare this breakthrough agreement where Larry Silverstein and the Port Authority finally would see eye to eye. But in effect, Larry Silverstein had them over the barrel. And what that agreement amounts to is over for the next 10 years, Larry Silverstein will pay for no construction on the site. The Port Authority will be paying for all of it.
Are we talking about a memorial or about rebuilding a brand new building there?
New buildings. We're talking about building the new buildings. The memorial has basically been built and paid for. By the way, I saw the memorial, and the memorial is a failure. It's meaningless. It's two giant pits, which are something out of a bad dream, and they don't mean anything. When I went down there, I was looking at it for a while, and I turned to a couple that was next to me, and I said, you know, this doesn't mean anything. And the other man who was just looking at it with a rather despondent look on his face said, he said, they forgot to do something.
So how did they come up with that model?
Just out of desperation. They had a design competition where 5,000 people submitted entries, but if you looked at the entries, easily 99% of them were ridiculous and bizarre. And they settled on this because they had a small clique of people who were deciding what the memorial would be, and they excluded the victims' families really from any participation. And they chose some basic pits where the Twin Towers originally stood, and to have waterfalls there. They were going to have them originally with galleries in the sides of the waterfalls where people would be underground and they could look through the openings in the waterfall and see the names of all the victims who were killed on plaques inside the pools in the waterfall. But about 2.5 or 3 years after they decided on the waterfall design, they realized that winds would blow the water. People would be looking through the waterfall
and getting wet.
At the names, and they yes, exactly. Winds would blow water into the open galleries and make people wet. And in the winter, who knows? It would be an awful problem. So they gave up on the open galleries, and then they decided to put the names above ground. And the memorials are just one of many problems on the site. I think the major problem that they did with the site was the site plan. And whenever you do a building project, the most important thing is the site plan. You have to put a lot of thought to decide what you want to build there. And after the Twin Towers came down, there was talk about changing the site plan, having a memorial on the site, possibly where the Twin Towers stood. And in the early stages, there was some local neighborhood groups which did not want any large-scale development on the site. So they pushed for the requirement to bring back the original old streets before the World Trade Center was built.
You mean, and not to have any sort of major building there at all?
Yes, that is correct. And so to prevent major building, they were pushing for to bring back all the original old streets from the horse and buggy days, and where the site had
you mean
many
cobblestone streets.
Oh, well, no, but the original street grid. The formation of the original street grid, which broke up the site into perhaps a dozen small blocks. And a few other community organizations supported that too, which did not want large-scale development on the project. Now, the reason there originally was a large block there to rebuild the World Trade Center is because small blocks are not conducive to building large buildings. And but anyway, they were under Governor Pataki. There was a lot of pressure just to proceed with and go along with decisions that already had been made, even if those decisions were just totally impractical. And later, they decided to build large-scale development on the site with the original old street grid with many small blocks. Now, if you imagine the site. They didn't restore all the old streets. If you imagine this site as being roughly like a tic-tac-toe board with 3x3 blocks, the lower left-hand corner of four square blocks is now reserved for the memorial area where the Twin Towers stood. Mm-hmm. And then the upper three blocks and the right-hand three blocks would be for the commercial buildings and the travel center. But they have the commercial buildings are just jam-packed against each other. There's very little room for sidewalks.
I see. So by just sort of changing the structure of the way the streets are set up, it could make it difficult to make a large building.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So they made a decision to have small blocks which are not conducive to large buildings, and then they later decided to build large buildings anyway. there's so many basic fundamental mistakes on the site. Right. The Freedom Tower or World Trade Center One, the largest building on the site, that's being built in the upper northwest corner of the site. That's the worst place to build a commercial building on the site. But the reason they decided to build it there is because Pataki was in a rush, and that was the first place on the site where you could build a large building due to they had drainage requirements and they had slurry wall requirements. And they built that building. It's being built over existing train tracks. So that large skyscraper does not have a conventional basement, and they have that's why the first roughly 20 or 30 floors of the building are just a solid wall. There's no windows, nothing in there. There's building equipment in there. They have the electrical switching equipment for that building is located at another location. The mistakes at that site just go on and on.
That's really quite something. We are talking to Bernard Goetz, who 30 or so years ago became famous for waking up New Yorkers about the risks and the possibilities of changing the way that they look at the world and that they didn't have to live in a city full of crime. And in fact, since that time, it's really become a great city with much less crime. In fact, I used to work at the World Trade Center. We've been talking to to Bernard Goetz about what had happened, and I always say that it was pretty good that I moved to Israel because otherwise I might have still been working there. I'd like to understand something. One of the issues that people talk about with building another huge tower, another huge monument, is it's just another target, and New York obviously is a target for the terrorists who are continuing to say they want to hit New York again and hit the world again. Should something be done to avoid that problem other than just building another huge building?
Well, no, you can't live your life that way. You can't reduce your standard of living because you're afraid of terrorism or others. Everything is a target in the modern world. The White House is a target. The bridges and tunnels in New York City are a target. Grand Central Station here in Manhattan is a target. So everything is going to be a target.
Do you think it's possible to defend, you know, to build buildings and train stations and bridges and defend them?
Well, you pay a price. It all depends on security. You can't guard everything. So far, the world has been pretty lucky with this, most of the world with terrorism. I know that Israel has a more severe problem than other places, but if you look at almost all the bombings, it seems that the Muslim extremists feel that the real battleground is Iraq. That they have more suicide bombings in Iraq by far than the whole rest of the world combined.
I guess a lot more of them are there, but certainly there's been in London and in Spain and around the world. I mean, people are taking a lot of steps just because they're concerned. But I agree with you. I think it's impossible to protect every major location, especially with the type of systems that are in place now.
Oh, yes. By the way, also with the World Trade Center, in terms of restoring the original streets to the site, they only realized 3 years ago that they decided if they were going to have the original streets going through the site, that would be unacceptable because truck bombs could then go through the site. So they're basically blocking off all the streets that are basically will not have any access to vehicular traffic except for one street, which is going to be very heavily guarded, and everything will have to be searched that wants to drive on that street so thoroughly that people won't. It's much more convenient for people to drive around the site than to drive through it on one street. But they're basically, even though now they've eliminated the streets, they've kept the site plan the same in terms of the location of the buildings. It's just ridiculous.
So is Lower Manhattan going to lose a lot of businesses? They'll just move up to Westchester?
I wouldn't say that. New York City has a good winning combination in the modern world in the United States. We're the only city in the United States with a good public transportation system. Here in the city, people don't need to own a car. And I don't know if you, when you lived in New York, if you owned a car or not, but only a small minority of people who live in the city own a car. And so the city may be successful regardless. I think the World Trade Center site, though, is going to be a financial drain on the city for decades to come, and it's going to be an embarrassing failure.
Oh, man. Okay, we have been talking to Bernard Goetz from New York City, who's talking a lot these days about what's going on in the World Trade Center and the World Trade Center Memorial. I just want to, again, note that 30 or so years ago, when I was growing up in New York, I remember the story when he defended himself. And as a result of taking a stance against crime, I think not that it was the only cause, but it certainly helped to change the mentality of New York residents to realize that they would be able to perhaps live in safety one day, which is, I think, how they are living. Bernard Goetz, thank you so much for joining us today.
Okay, you're welcome.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Doug's weekly radio show is heard around the world, but if you miss it, you can download the podcast at www.goldsteinongelt.com. The Goldstein on Gelt show gives you up-to-date financial ideas so you can get on the path to financial freedom. If you'd like your questions answered on the air or off, send Doug an email to doug@profile-financial.com. It's your money for your future, so join Doug every week to build your wealth on the Goldstein on Gelt show.